just allows our facilities to be available to all our learners, but at the same time, it breaks the backbone of apartheid planning. You know, you can't separate geographic areas from benefits because of the Group Areas Act. You know, good schools were at areas where they were highly advanced, whereas some of our schools were in areas where they were less developed. So this resolution or this court case gave us an opportunity to balance the landscape and ensure that those parents that can afford to take their children to any particular school, they must not be hindered or be asked where they come from, whether they can afford or they can't afford. So it's a very important case, and I really believe that the stakeholders within the education system will manage it appropriately.
Would you say that this, you mentioned apartheid spatial planning, but it has a sense of the last bastion, if one can call it that, that we've seen within schools, this being used to exclude not just those living around, but we've got other instances where this policy has been used to exclude.
Well, unfortunately, you know, and that's the most painful part, is that on top of the rules and regulations that we had, some of the schools created their own rules. One, they will request parents to produce the payslip or salary advices, which simply means that if you can't afford that school fees, your child cannot get access to quality education. So it means our education system will only be available to the privileged few. Secondly, they will ask something that is called confidential reports. In those confidential reports, if you are moving from school X to school Y, school Y will ask school X whether the parent is a good parent, whether the parent attend meetings, whether the parent can afford, whether the parent is not problematic. By that, it means that they are denying the child the right to access to education on the basis of the conduct of the parent, which is something that is not there within our rules and regulations. But we're quite excited that it will also alleviate pressure. You know what happens is that most people believe that the pressure is only on former Model C schools. The pressure actually is on township schools, because if former Model C schools don't want to accept you, where do you go? You go back to the township schools. And that's where you find that you have to buy new furniture, you have to buy new textbook, appoint new principals, appoint new teachers, purely because of the large number. So this judgment will then distribute equally the resources and the facilities across the system.
The thing that disturbs me is that school governing bodies have been using this as a sort of smokescreen for the kind of activities that happen on the school grounds as well. On a personal note, my son is at a school here in Johannesburg where they're not allowed to play soccer on the school grounds. Although the school has a rugby heritage and lots of facilities, there are always the argument, no, we don't have space for football. Will this ruling help in us breaking the back of that kind of, I would want to call it, interference?
Definitely. I mean, schools should be centers of unearthing talent. Schools must not be centers that block talent or discourage talent. You know, so if a school behaves in that particular fashion, I'll be disappointed. And I'll be the first one to intervene to find a way why that school is not providing learners an opportunity. I mean, to deny a learner even to bring a soccer ball inside the school premises is really disturbing. But let me tell you what this judgment says. It says that you can be taught in your mother tongue.
Yeah.
If you want to be taught in Afrikaans, you can be taught in Afrikaans. Mm. What we are saying as a department, when you are taught in your mother tongue, it does not mean you must exclusively be alone in that school. There can be somebody who can be taught in English in the same school, so that there is intercultural relations and social cohesion within the school premises. But people believe that it has to be them and them alone. So only their children matters. Other children don't matter. And it's something that we want to persuade. And I've asked our office to convene a meeting with various communities, especially the African community, because there is a new swart gevaar now. People say this judgment means that the standard of education will drop, there will be overcrowding in the classroom, will not have access to quality education. And I can assure you, people who are uttering those statements, they've got ulterior agenda. Yeah. We want quality education to be available to everyone, and that quality education must not be expensive and must be accessible.
And we have to share the burden fully. Want to ask you, though, the on the back of what you've said, the school governing bodies, they put forward, they say the power is being taken away from them. Your reaction to that, or is it a case of there's been a misuse of power in a way?
There's been lots of it. Remember, schools are the center of community. So the community around the school has the right to influence the direction of that school as well. But SGB believed that it's only the parents inside that school that have a right to influence the direction of the school. Hence this contradictions that we wanted to sharpen and clear. Our belief is simple. The school belongs to all of us. Let's work together through the SGBs, because they're playing a very important role. They're sacrificing their time. They're sacrificing their skills to ensure that there's quality education around those schools. But don't abuse that power. Let's work together. We will not abuse the new power that we have acquired. We are not going to bulldoze everyone to say, just because the Constitutional Court has agreed with us, it's us alone, no one else. We'll work together with those SGBs. But what is very important is the interest of the learner that must be taken into consideration.